All right, ready?
Hit it, Johnny. Here we go. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Source Material. 217th episode coming at you right here from the Rattlitchin Broadcasting Network studios. And we are here to talk about an exciting book. Mark's been he's just been excited. He talked to me earlier today. He said, Jesse, I cannot wait to talk about this book. There's going to be, I'm going to have to trim it down to at least 2 hours, but I have so much I want to say. And that is... He's already snoring. that is Batman, Hellboy, Starman. So
Starbreaker, riding through the sky, bam, 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 Starbreaker. Sorry, go ahead.
Tell me who that is, because I have never heard that before.
I feel like that's Judas Priest, but the version I know, yeah, I've heard like different covers of it.
We got Arch Enemy, we have Traveler, and...
Mm-hmm. I think I was doing the Arch Enemy version.
Okay. Yeah, Judas Priest, Traveler, Arch Enemy... Apparently 6 feet under did a cover of it. Graveyard Class. Nice. Oh, hey, ladies and gentlemen, Batman, Hellboy, Starman. Okay. Now, Mark, we picked this. You thought it'd be interesting. We're tying this in with something. I don't know what. What in the world are we tying this in with?
Well, there's only 3 choices. And the first two don't count. Okay. The book is called Batman, Hellboy, Starman. Take a wild guess which one's got a movie coming out.
I wonder, sir.
I wonder whom who wrote the book of love.
Hellboy. So they got he's got a new movie. This is his third movie, isn't it?
This is a reboot.
Oh, it's a reboot. I ain't even watched the second one yet. You guys are doing the second one coming up, aren't you?
We're doing a long road to ruin on both the original by Guillermo del Toro, and then Under the Golden Shower, or whatever it's called. Hellboy 2, the Golden Army. Hellboy 2, the Golden Army. That's what it is. We're gonna bring back Long Road to Ruin so we can discuss both of those.
Oh, that's tremendous. I am so happy that we actually get to have a Long Road to Ruin. I ain't had one of those in, jeez Louise, it's been years, hasn't it?
Yeah, it's been quite a few, but we're also gonna do the German Scheisse video Under the Golden Shower.
Oh, boy. All right. Okay. Well, we got 3 characters here. One for sure, Batman. We all know, we've talked about him ad nauseum on this podcast, on this network. Hellboy, though, this I think is the first time we'll be talking about him in regards to comics anyway on the Source Material podcast. So let me just go ahead quick, give a description of who Hellboy is. Created by Mike Mignola, who does our art here for these 2 books. But by the way,
is that what we're calling it?
Oh boy. All right. I had a feeling you would have an issue with the art. I just had a feeling. And we can address.
It's not good.
It's Mike Mignola, who's been in the comic business.
I don't care Joe DiMaggio. It sucks. The art in this is terrible.
This is his signature style, sir. This is iconic.
Signature style is code for I can't draw better than this.
Okay, so Hellboy was created by Mike Mignola, who is...
Why can't we get guest stars on here?
I don't know. Talking about pissing on things, we piss apparently all over comic creators on this show. Line them up, piss right on them.
Come get your golden shower, Todd McFarlane.
That'll never happen on this podcast, ever. So Mike Mignola created Hellboy back in, apparently, first appearance, 1993. Just to give you guys an idea of what this guy looks like, he's big, he's red, he had 2 horns that he shaved off, and he's somewhat of a superhero that deals with paranormal dealings, I guess.
And he has 1 arm bigger than the other from jerking off.
That's a lot of jerking off, sir. That is a lot of jerking off. Ability, superhuman strength and endurance, accelerated healing, longevity, extensive knowledge of the supernatural, right hand of doom. There you go. That's the right hand of doom, you know.
Told you.
Innate capability to comprehend magical languages and immunity to fire and lightning. All right, so there you go. That's who Hellboy is. This came out in early 1999, January and February 1999. It's a crossover. Hellboy is normally a Dark Horse property, and of course Batman and Starman are both DC properties, so it's fun to kind of see a company. I know we've done a few company crossovers, but they're rare, you know, you don't see them a whole lot. This was written by a guy by the name of James Robinson, who he is also a pretty big name in DC lore. He had his hand in writing a lot of Starman.
Who is Starman, Jesse?
Yeah, well, you know, that's a good question, because Starman was a Golden Age character originally. This guy, created by Gardner Fox and artist Jack Burnley, the original Starman, Ted Knight.
Ooh, better get rid of those gophers, or I'll be looking for a new greenskeeper.
I'm not that Ted Knight. First appeared in Adventure Comics 61, April of 1941. So that's our older gentleman here that we get at the beginning of this story. And then from that point forward, there have been a lot of star men. There was, my goodness, I can't even count. It's at least on the order of 10 or more. But the other one that shows up in this book is Jack Knight, who is Ted's son, Jack Knight. Jack, apparently his first appearance was Zero Hour Crisis in Time. That's an event for you right there, September of 1994. But Starman, yeah, he's got some interesting powers. He has this thing called an astronomer Knight invented a gravity rod, later reinvented as a cosmic rod, allowing him to fly and manipulate energy, and donned a red and green costume with a distinctive finned helmet. There you go. That's who Starman is. Now, the big question mark, Radulich, is, okay.
Why am I giggling like an idiot?
I know part of that is because of lack of sleep. It has to. Now, have you ever read anything with Hellboy in it? I can tell.
No, I'll be honest with you. I've never read any Hellboy. I didn't know who a Hellboy was until I saw the movie. When I saw that they were rebooting the Hellboy, I initially had Hellboy Volume 1 in there. And I'm like, nah, I don't necessarily want to read just a Hellboy comic. Let's see what other fun things there are. And I happened to see Batman, Hellboy, Starman. And I'm like, okay, that seems fun.
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, how about Starman? I mean, we've read a little bit of DC. I don't think we've had anything with Starman in it, but have you?
No, but later this year, there's going to be, I think, a Star Girl, a Star Woman, or a Star Whore.
Horse! Talking about Star Horse!
Star Horse! Con smile, you cunt. There's going to be a Star Girl show, which they've begun.
Is it DC Universe?
Yeah.
Animated, or do you know if it's live action?
Live action, baby.
Oh, shit.
And of course, there was a Star Girl that was on Legends of Tomorrow. She was in the episode where they dealt with the Hoosie Wutsies.
Oh, shit. I remember that one.
The Justice Society.
Oh, okay. Oh, at the beginning then, of the first, and then, like, it, first two seasons, or first two episodes.
Yeah, and then she ends up guarding the staff of Jesus.
Okay.
The Jesus staff.
Jesus
staff. The Spear of Destiny, that's what it was.
Ah, okay. Now, I've read some Hellboy in the past, and I remember actually being pretty impressed with the story that was being told. Hellboy, you know, like we said, there's a lot of paranormal stuff and it's always Nazis. And if you've seen it in the movies, you'll kind of get the gist of what the comic book's about. Starman, though, again, I'm right there with you, Mark. I don't think I've read much of anything with that character in it, but I have heard, I'm pretty certain that one of the runs that James Robinson did in the 90s was actually very well received. So a lot of people said that it's something that it's worth going back and reading for. So I haven't done it. One of these days maybe I'll check it out. But okay, well, let me get into the synopsis here real quick, and then we'll quickly go over what our thoughts of the book, if we have anything that sticks out to us. And then it's not going to be a really involved episode, because trust me, these two books, number one, thank goodness they're not overladen with dialogue. That's the word I'm looking for. This is straight from the wiki. I'm phoning it in, ladies and gentlemen. I don't give a shit. Issue one, I was up late. I watched WrestleMania.
Which is still going.
Yeah, apparently Mark's still trying to. He's actually calling in from the parking lot at the MetLife Stadium. Issue one, Gotham Grey Evil. So when Golden Age Starman Ted Knight is kidnapped by neo-Nazi skinheads whilst giving a lecture on alternative energy sources, Batman and Hellboy team up to rescue him. The duo eventually track the group calling itself the Knights of October to a deserted airfield. But in the ensuing battle, their leader, Dance, escaped with the prisoner on board.
The leader, Dan?
Dance.
Oh, Dance. Okay. I thought it was Dan.
Not Dan.
their leader, Sal.
Dance. It might be Dance, because it's German.
Dance, magic, dance.
Yeah, dance. So yeah, dance, dance.
That's D-A-N-T-Z, by the way.
That's right. Thank goodness you spelled that out.
Dance.
They escape with Ted Knight on board a small plane. Hellboy vows to go after him, but Batman is called away to deal with an escaped Joker. So Ted's son, who shows up in the very last page, Jack Knight, the new Starman, joins the mission. We head into issue 2. Batman bids farewell as Hellboy and Starman board Bruce Wayne's private jet for the trip into the Amazon rainforest. And as soon as they bail out of the plane over the target, they come under fire. Once they penetrate the defenses, they learn that Dance is using Knight's scientific knowledge to reanimate the demonic Shugor Yogaroth.
Let me simplify this. So they're using some sort of light cannon to bring to life Audrey 2 from Little Shop of Horrors.
How would you like to be a big wheel? Dining out for every meal. I'm the plan to make it all real. You're going to get it.
And the entire book 2 is Hellboy.
You're going to get it.
The entire book 2 is Hellboy punching Nazis until there are no more Nazis left to punch.
Yeah, there's some bad stuff going on. Hellboy invokes an ancient Lemurian incantation to dispel the demon, then the duo are able to drive it back and release the captive Knight. That's Ted Knight.
How about a Fresca?
Oh.
Huh?
Not that Ted Knight, but Ted Knight. So, Mark Radlich, I'm making the Ted Knight joke all night.
What did I think of the book? I thought there was a lot of Nazi punching.
Yeah, there was. Quite a bit. I mean, did you enjoy yourself? Did you have a good time reading the book?
Here's the good, the bad, and the ugly on this. The right. Good. It's a very cinematic story. It was very straightforward. It was, you know, it was essentially a rescue operation, and they punched a lot of Nazis. It was a very cinematic, simple story. Very straightforward. I like the interactions between Batman and Hellboy. The interactions between Hellboy and Starman. I didn't think there was anything much to it. They were just like, we got a job to do, and they did it, and then it was done.
Yeah.
I thought the Batman stuff had a little bit more to it when they were trying to figure out the initial mystery of it all. And then Starman shows up and says, I'm here too. And then Batman takes off. There's just too many of us in this book, and he takes off. So
we can't have three of us on an adventure.
But then, like, when we get right down to it, I mean, you get to see Hellboy go full Hellboy. That was fun. The bad, I mean, there's not much bad to it. Like I said, it might be overly simple, which is why we've talked about everything but the book tonight. Like I got done with it, and I'm just like, well, this is going to be another one of those episodes. It's going to be a half an hour long with an hour long gag reel.
Because I'm a mean, green mother from outer space. Outer
space, and I'm mad. The artwork looks like it was drawn by a child with chalk.
Wow. So sorry, Mike Mignola. And anybody else who actually respects his work. Go ahead and continue, Mark.
I believe Mike Mignola drew this comic with his dick. Just put a pencil, wrapped it in his dick, and proceeded to try to draw Batman.
Sir, there's some talent there if that's the case. There is some talent. One of the things that I did actually prior to making notes for the show tonight, I hopped on to a friend of ours, a guy who participated in the Superblog team up along with us, Chris Sheehan. He has a blog that is called Chris is on Infinite Earths. Get that? That's a good one. Chris is on Infinite Earths. So he does he did a blog, and he actually did a piece on these two issues back in 2017. So Chris has this to say on his blog. He says, Batman was really kind of standoffish with Hellboy upon their meeting atop Gotham Central PD. He seemed quite put off at the thought of having to work with him, almost taking it as a blow to his ego. His not knowing the difference between electricity and magic seemed to really bother him. Having to rely on a subject matter expert really must have put him in his place. So that's a good point. You know, Batman is the greatest detective of the DC universe. You know, he is
they might even say he's the world's greatest detective.
Yes, sir. They might even do that. But here we have Hellboy who shows up, and we do have one of the neater aspects of this book, which is depicting science and magic against each other. Batman rests upon all of the most science. You look at any of his gadgets, he's definitely not a magic-based superhero in any way. Starman character is also that way. So it's interesting to see them have to deal with those elements. And what we find out is that the villains who are using Ted Knight, the scientist, and his knowledge of the stars to bring forth this Lovecraftian deity. That's probably about the neatest part of the story. Of course, the big centerpieces here are the characters. Did Batman feel like Batman to you, Mark?
Yeah, I thought he felt more like Batman than some other things we've read.
I'm right there with you. He felt like Batman to me. Hellboy, again, center character here, centerpiece of what's going on, you know, magic base. Superhero, felt like Hellboy in the little bit that I've read him.
Normally, you get kind of a Batman as your central detective. It's kind of his niche. It was fun to see Hellboy sort of like the magic detective.
Mm-hmm. And Starman being...
Starman had a magic stick that he will... that he waved around and created light with.
For kinda this like, story...
Kind of like what my son does.
Right after he comes home from a trip from Disney, he's got his light sticks.
That's right. He's just waving them around.
For a story that was written by one of the guys, you know, that is champion at writing Starman, he didn't really like make him stick out at all in this.
No, like I said, if you gave my son a flashlight, he would wave it around like a sword.
Mm-hmm.
That's what this guy did.
Yeah.
And I feel like his stick, that's all it was like a giant flashlight.
How about our villains, the Knights of October? I mean...
A bunch of crazy and whining Nazis.
Yep.
Who might as well have said, we'll get you, you know, my pretty and your little dog, too.
Why are like Nazis always after shit involving the
occult? Because the occult leads to powers of magic, and it would have given and theoretically if any of this shit were true and they were able to acquire it, they would have had an advantage in the war.
Is that something that's like actually happened where they
I've heard the same things, but this isn't a subject that I've studied a lot in, so.
Well, I mean, we both watched Raiders of the Lost Ark.
Yeah, we did.
Okay. And that's kind of what happens there, right? I mean, they're all
this happens in quite a few. It was also the Last Crusade.
Yeah, it was the Last Crusade as well. So I didn't know if that was actually something that was born in reality or
I can't really say for certain. Like I said, I've never really studied the Nazi obsession with occultism. I just know that they were after whatever weapons they could find to end the war and be successful.
Give me a second. I'm gonna come up with another couple questions to ask you that you don't know the answers to. Give me just a second. Okay. rule number one of podcasting: ask your guests questions they have no idea about.
Right? I'll just be happy to make up an answer. Yes,
I like it.
The Nazis were desperate to find occult weapons.
Okay, I want to go ahead and kind of talk about the. And
You got to remember. After World War I, they weren't allowed to have an army. It was part of the 1919 Paris Agreement. They weren't allowed to actually have an army, so they had to send out explorers and, you know, scientists, whatever, to find occult stuff so that they could blow up the Earth because it blocked their view of Venus.
And you're quoting this from what book, sir?
Right,
cite your sources.
Keep asking me questions, sir.
Show your work, motherfucker. All right. Okay. I mean, there's not. That's it. I mean, there. That, ladies and gentlemen, that's our coverage, pretty much. I mean, I think one of the. But really, there isn't a whole lot to say here.
That's Jesse giving up.
Well,
I'm done here.
I can't drag a whole lot out of this story because there's not really. Here's the problem. When you have a company crossover, you have a choice. You can write a story that shows the intricacies of your character and how it deals with this other character from a completely different company. One of the big things that they always say is that the concept of the two characters coming together is overshadows really what the story is going to be a lot of times.
It was definitely like, oh, look at all these people we have in the same comic and less about the story.
Yeah, and you can't write a story that – I don't think you can write a story that really matters. And I think that's what they did here. It's oversimplifying things because they don't want to – they don't feel that they can really write a great epic storyline involving these characters. One of the things that he said here was this was a great two and done. It feels as though things happened, but nothing so great that it will need to be addressed in the future. Not an out of continuity waste of time by any stretch. Just a nice story utilizing fun characters.
I'd like to add they're in and out repeatedly until they're finished.
No, it's just tough to write a story that, you know, it really is something that is going to grab the readers and make them go, oh my goodness, this is one of the best company crossovers. You just kind of hamstrung when that happens. So anyway, I know there's probably some better crossovers out there that leave you going, okay, like Avengers JLA. A lot of stuff happens in that that I guarantee you, if we read that at some point, we're going to have some stuff to talk about. And then this one, it's just straight up, figure out who the bad guys are, what the hell's going on, stop the bad guys, boom, we're done. See you later, have a good time. Mark Radulich, plug, sir.
Last week was a split 7-inch between Shazam and wrestling, and we started our countdown to Endgame podcast, our 3-part podcast, focusing on the MCU leading into Endgame, where all things end and all things are games.
Oh, my goodness.
This week, it's Hellboy week all week long. We've got this today and tomorrow. You've got the Hellboy reboot on Debut Hollywood. I just came back from Jersey.
Oh, you fuck.
This week, we're going to review the new Overkill, The Wings of War. You fuck.
I hope they say that at least one time in the record.
And then on the 18th, we've got Hellboy. We've got the Long Road to Ruin Hellboy from 04 and 08. And then part two of the countdown to Endgame. The following week, it's tossed salad and scrambled eggs once again. We've got Green Lantern, Planet of the Apes. We've got Pet Cemetery, which I will not be on because I will be at Whitesnake, sitting in seats that I don't fit in. And then on the Metal Hammer of Doom, we'll be looking at the new Twar album. And then Thursday, there's no podcast because I will be at the Avengers. And then finally, we will end the week with Countdown to Extinction. No, Countdown to Endgame, the Marvel Phase 3. So that all leads into our coverage of the Avengers, but we'll get there when we get there.
Oh, yes. Right around the corner. Yeah. Hey, go check out the blog I mentioned there. Chris is on Infinite Earths. Check out that blog. You can check out the Radulich and Broadcasting Network on just about any platform out there. So, you know, Mark is back from WrestleMania. So am I.
Mark is never traveling without his wife ever again.
Was things like unorganized or something? Or did you just feel like you missed her?
I all you need to know is that Mark is done traveling. Unless his wife is involved and his kids.
Okay. All right, then. Well, for Mark Radulich,
who's done traveling unless his wife is involved.
Yes, he's done traveling. And for myself, Jesse Starcher,
who never travels to begin with.
I'd rather not go anywhere, to be honest. I went to a friend's house last night. I watched WrestleMania. I regretted just about 50% of it. If it wasn't for the fact that it was peace and quiet and actually sitting down and watching a show without having to worry about kids, different story. But anyway, I'm ready to go to bed. Mark's ready to pass out. We're getting the hell out of here. Just remember, I'm a mean green mother from outer space, and I'm bad. Have a good one, ladies and gentlemen.
Feed me, Seymour. Feed me all night long.
Later, guys. Bye. Thank you all for joining us. Make sure to give that Radulich in Broadcasting Facebook page a like to stay up on top of all the great podcasts we have to offer. We are at home on Spreaker, but you can also find us on iTunes, Stitcher, TuneIn Radio, and recently we have hit the air on Spotify. Find your favorite podcast platform and type in Radulich to subscribe for some great content. If you enjoyed this show, please feel free to share and spread the word. And as always, we appreciate any feedback and look forward to entertaining you again soon. Oh, I'm too tired for this shit. Last night, kissed my ass.
5, 6, 7. Fuck.
That's 2 more than 5.
Your mom's 2 more than 5.
Mom, are you 2 more than 5?
I need that to be a t-shirt, by the way. Mindy, put it on a t-shirt. You will believe a midget can be beat on. You know what would be fun?
Tell me.
If somebody ever did like a porn parody for Hellboy in a fisting video.
Ew, ah. Go on. Oh boy. Right hand of doom.
Yeah. That's what they call it.
Right under the golden shower. Part one, part two.
Boy, I hope somebody who makes porn is listening.
Yeah, please. That's the exact audience I was shooting for when I thought of this podcast about 4 years ago. Like, hands on your rod, ladies and gentlemen.
And when I saw that, you're gonna have to edit that out.
That'll be our bumper in between gag reel.
Oh, she had a gravity rod, all right.
She had it right in her hands.
Star
Wars.
Stargirl.
Talking about Star Wars. Is kidnapped. Not that Ted Knight. It's kidnapped.
What the fuck is wrong with you?
Fuck you, man.
Goodness gracious, Bobby Lashley just killed Dean Ambrose.
Okay.
Let's focus now.
Turn on the TV. Let's see what else is on.
Oh, look, it's Indiana Jones.
Oh, boy. Oh, the old hide the sausage. All week long.
All week.
I had the option to go see Shazam. I said, no, I don't want to.